Be Wise as Serpents by Fritz Springmeier. Continues. Chapter 2 Assassinating 3 Assassins. Continues Chapter 2.01 Second. The Origins of the Anglican Church. The Church of England was originally part of the Roman Catholic Church, and it retained its clergy and hierarchy from its Catholic days. The reader will recall that King Henry VII desired the privilege of divorce in order to marry Anne Boleyn. Henry VII went so far as to force the clergy of his realm on January 1531 to declare him supreme head of Christ's Church in England. In 1535 he declared himself in terra supremum caput Anglicani Ecclesiae, that is in Latin supreme head on earth of the English Church. That is the king/priest concept. Thomas Cromwell, who believed in that concept, was also a close co-worker with Henry VII, and his descendant Oliver is responsible for the Jews coming to England and for Anglo's realism becoming so prominent in the English Isles. The Church of England did make changes after their separation from Rome, but they were principally changes based on humanism and the Reformed movement rather than Luther's ideas. After the political separation of the Church of England from the Catholic Church, many of the problems that had plagued the Church during its years under Rome's authority continued and even grew. For instance, the Church of England became notorious for the practice called pluralism, that is where a clergyman will hold several church offices in order to draw pay from each, and yet the clergyman would not perform the function of but one office. When the separation with Rome occurred, and for many years afterward, the clergy in the Anglican Church were often poorly educated and had poor morals. Three ties to Masonry and British Israelism. The idea of British Israelism was so popular with the Anglican Church that many associate the two together. The form of British Israelism that the Anglican Church practices is perverse in that it elevates the Ashkenazim Jews to central position in the affairs of mankind, which God never promised them. King Alfred the Great, who reigned from 871 to 899, was positive he was 50th in direct descent from Adam. King James I, who was the first to call England Great Britain, had written on the gates to his throne Je 17:25, then shall enter into the gates of the city, kings and princes sitting upon the throne of David. The royalty of England, who have been leaders in British Freemasonry, have hinted often on that they believe that they are descendants of the House of David. A letter requesting clarification from the British Queen on this point has gone unanswered. Whether the royalty believes it or not, various researchers are saying they are descendants. On the books, technically the British royalty has immense powers, but the today's traditional way of handling things gives them very limited power. It is not inconceivable that they might someday regain in reality the power that is still on the books. Prince Charles is a New Ager 5, and when he visited the Pope in 1985 he attempted unsuccessfully to share the Mass with the Pope. 6. The Anglican Church is also so close to Masonry, the Anglican and Episcopal Churches are really extensions of Freemasonry. One scholar on Freemasonry describes the Church of England as paralyzed against Freemasonry. 7. Church officials, Anglicans and Presbyterians, have lost their jobs because they criticized Freemasonry. 8. So it is something that in 1987 the Masons ruling the Church of England allowed a group of Anglican priests called the Working Group, established by the Standing Committee of the General Synod of the Church of England, to publish a report questioning the compatibility of Freemasonry and the Church. The report says it points to a number of very fundamental reasons to question the compatibility of Freemasonry with Christianity. 9. Even though this is a step in the right direction, the report poses no threat to the Masonic power structure. Earlier in Chap 2, lists of Anglican and Episcopal priests and bishops is given. This is not a blanket condemnation of the Episcopal Church, nor can the motives of these men be questioned. However, to give documentation on how powerful Masonry and its daughter the New Age movement are in the Anglican/Episcopal Church, this data is given. Are we not to judge a tree by its fruit? Some of the top leaders of the New Age have come out of the Episcopal Church, and now in their pulpits some of the most anti-Christian, and some of the most perverted people are preaching. Many of the very top leaders are Masons. It has been popular for the Archbishop of Canterbury to be a Mason. The following are some of the Masons who have been at the top of the Anglican/Episcopal hierarchy in England. Dr. Jeffrey F. Fisher, Archbishop of Canterbury beginning in 1945. He was initiated into Masonry in 1916 and before he became the Archbishop and Primate, while only an Anglican bishop. He became the Grand Chaplain of the Grand Lodge of England in 1937 and 1939. William Howley, Archbishop of Canterbury, 1828-1848, an important Mason. Henry Sheshaly, another Archbishop of Canterbury, an important Mason. In Canada, Samuel Pritchard Matheson, 1852-1942, Bishop and Primate of all Canadian Anglican churches from 1909-1930, initiated into Masonry in 1874. D.T. Owen, 1878-1947, 33 degree, Primate of the Church of England in Canada, and Archbishop of Toronto. In the United States, also refer to the earlier listing of bishops and priests, Henry St. George Tucker, presiding bishop of the Protestant Epis. Church in the USA 1938-46. An overview of the extent of Freemasonry within the Anglican Church can be seen in an article by London's Daily Express which lists the numbers of Masons in the highest Anglican offices in 1960. In 1960, there were within the Anglican Church, 13 Mason Anglican bishops, including one Canadian and six retired. The Archbishop of Canterbury and the Archbishop of the West Indies were both Freemasons. Also there were 6 deans and provosts of cathedrals and 10 archdeacons, including those retired, who were Masons. 10. It's amazing that so many men have dedicated their lives to the Masonic institution. Bear in mind that these men, as they were initiated in lodge, were told in the ceremony, no institution can boast a more solid foundation than that on which Freemasonry rests, the practice of every moral and social virtue. Yet, the scriptures declare that for no other foundation can be laid except that which is Christ Jesus. To accept otherwise is a denial of Christianity. The reader can now understand better the common complaint that one of the requirements in order to rise in the Anglican hierarchy is to be a Mason. A pro-Jewish book written about a century ago indicates one reason the Masons may be popular within the Anglican hierarchy. It is known that 5 of the bishops and over 300 of the clergy of the Church of England are either Jews or of Jewish descent. 11 Early Episcopal Church and Masonry. The Church of England was especially strong in colonial Virginia, and somewhat also in colonial Maryland. The Episcopalian who is sometimes called the father of Freemasonry, Henry Price, 1697-1780, came to Boston, Massachusetts in 1723 and convened a regular lodge in 1733 in Boston. 12 Irregular lodges had been meeting in the colonies previous to this. James Madison, the first Episcopalian bishop in colonial Virginia, was also an active Mason. 13 In discussing the colonial time period, C.S. Coles, 32 degree, writes in the New Age magazine, October 1921. Page 468, in those days too, Freemasonry was largely confined to the members of the Episcopal Church among English-speaking people, both Scottish and English Masonry having its main support among the members of the established churches, and it is a fine thing to know that in those days the Church and Masonry went hand in hand in performing works of charity and goodwill. Today the Episcopal Church takes the same position as the Masons in regard to the great public school system of our country, the past century having worked a revolution in our methods. The Church of England controlled its churches in the colonies through the office of the Bishop of London, who appointed commissaries for the colonies to carry out his orders. By the time of the Aymer Revolution, there were 300 Anglican churches and 250 Anglican clergymen in the 13 colonies. 14 Rev. Jasper Adams. The Rev. Jasper Adams, 1793-1841, is an example of early Episcopalian leaders. He was a Mason and well-known Episcopalian clergyman during the early years of this country. He served as the chaplain and a professor at West Point. He eventually started a private seminary at Pendleton, SC 15 Heresy and the Anglican Church. The Anglican Church has embraced men of all forms of persuasion. From the Anglican Church have come men like John Taylor, who became the LDS Church's third president. John Taylor was the descendant of Richard Whittington, 3 times mayor of London. He had been exposed to both Masonry and the Anglican Church's Anglo's realism, both of which Mormonism encompasses. He also was a Methodist minister for a spell. He declared that Christianity was hatched in hell and was a perfect pack of nonsense. The devil could not invent a better engine to spread his work. 16. In other words, when we get the bigger picture, we see new religious groups which we had pictured as new formations drawing their blood from many religious heritages, but which were actually in many ways just regroupings of Masonic thinkers accompanied by those who they were able to get to follow and submit to them. William Temple in 1921, William Temple, 1881-1944, was made Bishop of Manchester and in 1942 the Archbishop of Canterbury. William Temple is quite well known, especially for his ecumenical activities. He was instrumental in promoting the World Council of Churches and the unification, union, of the various British Protestant denominations, which unified under the British Council of Churches. He was chairman of the Provisional Committee of the World Council of Churches. W.R. Inga W.R. Inga, 1860, Dean of St. Paul's Cathedral in London is another well-known Anglican. He has promoted mysticism and Platonism. James Parks Morton. James Parks Morton, Dean of the Episcopal Cathedral of St. John the Divine, New York City, is openly a New Age leader. He is on record as in favor of the New Age plan, called Planetary Initiative, to unify the world under a one-world religion, one-world government. And he is doing all he can to promote its happening. For Pentecost, he invited every type of religious group into commune with his church. For a Thanksgiving celebration he did the same. He describes this, so at Pentecost we invited the head rabbi of New York, the abbot of the Zen community, Satchitananda, a Hindu, Oren Lyons, an American Indian, the head imam at the mosque, and we all stood around the altar and prayed for peace in our own languages. Then we all received communion. Some church people said, "How can you do that? They don't know what they're receiving." I say, "Well, I don't really know what I'm receiving either." We're increasingly being called to realize that the body of Christ is the earth, the biosphere, the skin that includes all of us. 17. For Thanksgiving in 1988, James Morton invited in witches, medicine men, nature worshippers, and American Indians, and they danced around in a circle dance to promote friendship and unity. Morton stated that the dance was to create a heightened consciousness of the necessity of different religions working together to save our planet. 18. President Bush. It is no surprise then, considering the Episcopalian support for a Masonic world religion and a one-world government, that 33-degree Freemason George Bush 19, who hopes to be the one in office to have the honors of bringing in the New World Order, would as U.S. President turn to such men as the R.T. Rev. Edmund L. Browning, presiding bishop of the Episcopalian Church in the United States. Another reverend that Bush turned to during the Kuwait crisis was the Senate chaplain, Rev. Richard C. Halverson. 20 Episcopalians have rejected Christ. Not only have homosexuals, Satanists, and New Agers spoken from the Episcopalian pulpits, but in 1990 at the Michigan Episcopal Diocese, a resolution by those Episcopalians who apparently still believe in the Bible was ignored. Their resolution, which was refused to be given to a vote, simply quoted the Bible that Jesus is the Christ, the only name given under heaven by which we may be saved. It was rejected for a vote, because it was said to be divisive and demeaning to people whose faith in God is as strong as ours, though it is differently defined. According to the Christian scriptures, this is really warped thinking. Although pretending to be different and Christian, actually the Episcopal Church, which now adheres to a social gospel, is preaching and defining faith in God just as the other religions. The Episcopal Church, by rejecting the Bible's definition of faith in God, is not able to see that witches, New Agers, Satanists, etc. do not have a faith in God. The issue that Episcopalian Masons raised, that one shouldn't demean other people's faith, is fake, for the Buddhists, witches, etc. do not have Christian faith. It is not true that Christians are rejecting other believers by believing in Scripture. An example of where the Episcopal clergy have gone is Newark's Episcopal Bishop John S. Spong, who talks about how he worships in a Buddhist temple. In the fall of 1988, I worshipped God in a Buddhist temple. As the smell of incense filled the air, I knelt before three images of the Buddha, feeling that the smoke could carry my prayers heavenward. It was for me a holy moment. Beyond the words and creeds that each religion uses, there is a divine power that unites us. I will not make any further attempts to convert the Buddhist, the Jew, the Hindu, or the Muslim. I am content to learn from them and to walk with them side by side toward the God who lives, I believe, beyond the images that bind and blind us. 21 Participation in the One World Religion. The Episcopalian Church is officially part of the One World Religion. A foreshadowing of the union of the large power religions of Christendom was seen in 1922, when the Greek Orthodox Church, specifically the Eastern Orthodox's Holy Synod of Constantinople, accepted the Anglican religious orders. The Archbishop of Canterbury committed the Church of England to the pact that the Global Forum of Spiritual and Parliamentary Leaders on Human Survival decreed. That pact resulted in a 5-day global forum where religious leaders of all persuasions, except Bible-believing Christians, were present. Also participating were the Archbishop of Canterbury, the normal host of Mason religious and spiritual leaders, U.S. senators, Soviet government officials, the UN Secretary General, the Dalai Lama, considered a god, and a host of other types like monks, Muslim imams, and rabbis. They declared that their commitment to a unified religion, which is supposedly necessary for global survival, is, in their words, commitments that are irrevocable. In January 15 to 19, 1990, they held another global forum in Moscow, USSR. That global forum called for a new planetary perspective involving a new spiritual and ethical basis for human activities on Earth. 22 Yes, they are proposing a new ethical basis for us, to replace that old-time religion so many Christians have sung about. Theirs is the revitalized Christianity, also known as the Masonic religion, that New Age leaders such as Bailey and Benjamin Cream say will be the One World religion. It is the religion of Masonry, which is described by Albert Pike, Masonry around whose altars the Christian, the Hebrew, the Muslim, the Brahmin, the followers of Confucius and Zoroaster, can assemble as brethren and unite in prayer to the one God. 23 The New Age plans to take over the Church. Masonry and its daughter the New Age do not plan to destroy the Church but to subvert it to their purposes. New Age writer William Thompson states, "The new spirituality does not reject the earlier patterns of the great universal religions. Priest and Church will not disappear, they will not be forced out of existence in the New Age, they will be absorbed into the existence of the New Age." 24 The Anglican Church is not being destroyed but rather subverted. And just as it was made to bow to the dictates of Henry VII, it is bowing to the dictates of the international power which plans to rule the world. The Anglican priests still have their churches but they are used for the New Age. An example of that is the historical St. James Anglican Church just off of Piccadilly Square. The church is a favorite for tourists, especially to the New Age type which it caters to. The church calls itself a 7 days a week church for London and the world. Within the church are held classes for all types of New Age religious activities such as health for the New Age, through meditation, visualization, lifetime astrology, yoga meditation. If you want to join the Sufi healing order which meets there, you can. 25 Episcopals like Bishop Louis Stuart Kaiser, who authored the 8th Revelation, reveals the 9th. A New Hermetic Initiation Discourse, 1974, are turning to the occult. Episcopal clergyman and professor at the Catholic Notre Dame University Morton T. Kelsey promotes the occult to Christians in his book The Christian and the Supernatural. This apostasy is causing much glee to hardcore New Agers. One said, "I am very glad to discover such strong movement within Christian churches that is sympathetic to the pagan spirit and willing to learn from the teachings of the old religion." 26. Notes 1. Laterett, Kenneth Scott. A History of Christianity, Volume 2. New York, Harper & Row, 1975, p. 806. 2 Ibid, page 972. 3. Ibid. CF with other histories on the clergy. 4. Holy Blood. Holy Grail mentions some recent sources including a French book. Winter, Gordon, and Wendy Kochman. Secrets of the Royals. New York, St. Martin's Press, page 86 refers to researchers making claims tying the House of Windsor to the House of David. 5. Texie Mars and other researchers are saying this. 6. Winter and Kochman, OPCIT page 86. 7. Knight, Stephen. The Brotherhood. London, UK. Granada Pub, 1984, pages 241-42, 254. 8 Ibid, pages 254, 262-9. The working group established by the Standing Committee of the General Synod of the Church of England. Freemasonry and Christianity, are they compatible? London, Church House, 1987, page 40. 10. Article in London's Daily Express, March 23, 1966, as quoted in The Unlocked Secret, p.40. 11. Poole, Reverend W. H. Anglo-Israel. Toronto, William Briggs, page 33. 12. Denslow, 10,000 Famous Freemasons, Volume I, page 366. 13 Ibid, V3, page 120. 14. Laterette, OPCIT, on Commissaries p. 953, on Clergy Figures page 956. 15. Information taken from both the National Cyclopedia of American Biography, Volume 12, page 520, and Denslow's 10,000 Famous Freemasons. 16. Journal of Discourses, Volume 6, pages 176 and 167-17. The Tarrytown Letter, November 1984, Building the Earth at St. John the Divine, A Gothic Cathedral Shapes a New Worldview and a Wider Vision of Humanity, page 5. 18. Austin American Statesman, November 24, 1988, page A4. 19. George Bush's Masonic membership is well known to Masons. After he became president in accord with revealing everything in accordance with the law, information was placed in the Library of Congress indicating his membership. As we gallop toward the New World Order, tighter censorship is coming into action. Records of Bush's membership have disappeared from the Library of Congress, and his staff is now denying his membership over the phone. George Bush's membership is referred to Schnobelin's latest book, and may be offhandedly referred to an ex-33 degree Mason Jim Shaw's book, although Shaw doesn't mention him by name. 20 Article by Karen Hosier of the Baltimore Sun. Bush speaks with clerics about war carried in the Oregonian, circa January 28, 1991. 21. The Voice, Diocese of Newark, January 1989-22. Dave Hunt does a good report of the activities of the various Global Forum meetings in his book Global Peace and the Rise of the Antichrist, Yun, or Harvest House, 1990, pages 156-57. He uses as his sources the newsletters and brochures produced by these Global Forums, Shared Vision, Global Forum of Spiritual and Parliamentary Leaders on Human Survival, Autumn 1987, page 5. Also Shared Vision, Global Forum's new letter, Summer 1988, page 12, and also the official brochure of Global Forum, headquartered in New York. 23. Pike, Albert. Morals and Dogma. Charleston, SC, Supreme Council of the Southern Jurisdiction, AASR, 1917, page 226. 24. William Thompson, Introduction, in David Spangler's Revelation, The Birth of a New Age. 25. Hunt, Dave, and T.A. McMahon. The Seduction of Christianity. Eugene, or Harvest House, 1987, page 71. 26. Miriam Starhawk in Circle Network News as quoted by Texie Mars in Dark Secrets of the New Age. Westchester, I.L., Crossway Books, 1987, page 204. Presbyterians, most of the Puritans were Presbyterians. And the congregational churches that rose out of the congregations of the Puritans worked in close cooperation with the Presbyterians. Theologically, the two were akin one. The state organizations in New England of the Congregationalists and the Presbyterian General Assembly had exchanged delegates beginning in the 1790s. They cooperated in sending missionaries, in the Home Missionary Society, and in the American Bible Society, begun in 1816. 249 colleges and universities, many of them now secular, were started by the Presbyterians. Many of the Presbyterians in the United States were from the Scot-Irish settlers that had moved to Northern Ireland, and left Ireland when the economic situation deteriorated. Charles T. Russell's family were part of this group. Presbyterians play an important role in the lodges. Various Presbyterian ministers have played important roles in the Masonic lodges. Presbyterian minister James Anderson was responsible for the Masonic Constitution and the development of modern Freemasonry. Presbyterian minister James Allen Cabanis wrote the Grand Lodge of Mississippi's official history, which was published in 1967, by the Grand Lodge. Masons have played prominent roles in the Presbyterian Church. This section must be prefaced by saying that the United Presbyterian Church is very close to Freemasonry. There are more United Presbyterians than all the other seven major Presbyterian denominations put together. There is in excess of 2 million American United Presbyterians in 9,000 churches. In contrast, the Orthodox Presbyterian Church had only 16,590 members in the 1982 Yearbook of American and Canadian Churches, and the Presbyterian Church of North America was listed having but 4,878.5. The small Reformed Church finally took an official stand against Freemasonry in 1942. The one Presbyterian denomination prior to that time that took a clear stand against Freemasonry was the Associate Presbyterian Church, which following the 1757 secession tradition had forbidden Masonic membership. In writing this part concerning the Presbyterians, I have taken the liberty to lump the various groups together in the same section. However, they can in no way be lumped together in their response to Freemasonry and the One World Power. Examples of Presbyterian Masons working on the functional church level are Robert W. Cretney, 33 degree, Deacon Presbyterian Church, Morton Page Steyer, KT, 32 degree, Shriner, York Rite College, Royal Order of Scotland, and Elder Presbyterian Church, and Hugh I. Evans, 33 degree, KT, National Head of the Presbyterian Church, USA. 33rd degree Mason Hugh I. Evans, 1887-1958, deserves some note here. He represented the U.S. at the meeting of the World Council of Churches in Holland in 1948. He was the national head of the Presbyterian Church, USA in 1950-51. In 1955, he became the director of the foundation of the Presbyterian Church at NYC. And he served for a while as the president of the Board of National Missions. The newsletter Free the Masons, August 1990, says on the other end of that, however, is the church on whose board sit lodge members, or whose deacons or elders share Masonic secrets. These secrets reflect their higher allegiance to the lodge, and seem to produce an aloofness from the rest of the church body. These are good men who attend regularly and are often the financial backbone of many small congregations. One pastor wrote of his frustration in a rural church. He put it this way: as faithful as these men are, I always feel at board meetings that there is a second agenda which is not open to me. It's like they get their marching orders from the lodge on how to conduct the business of the church. They are good men, but they seem to operate with some higher knowledge than the rest of us. There is no submission to the authority of the church and its members. Sometimes Masonic literature shows its true colors almost to the point of being embarrassing. The book Standard Freemasonry states that Presbyterians are bad material for the lodge until they go against their church. 6. The Proceedings of the Grand Lodge of Oregon, 1870, page 209 states that the world is a good place when the Presbyterian Church shares its pulpit with a Jewish rabbi in Salem, or The Alabama Grand Lodge reported in 1889 that out of its 7,950 Freemasons in the state, 483 were Christian ministers. The New York Grand Lodge report of 1890 gives us the breakdown of the 703 Christian clergymen that were NY. Masonic members: Methodist, 288, Episcopalian, 146, Baptist, 112, Presbyterian, 59, Universalist, 31, Congregationalist, 21, Dutch Reformed, 13, Christian, 13, Lutheran, 11, Jewish, 7, Unitarian, L, Reformed Jew, 1. 8. The New Age and the Presbyterian Churches. The United Presbyterian Church put out a report on occult and psychic activities in 1976 that gave a positive report to various occult activities. It encourages the study of the occult within the churches, p.3. The medium Olga Worrell's book The Gift of Healing gets a favorable review. One of the seven on the task force that wrote up the report was Mrs. Margaret Harmon Brough, who was a medium and the co-founder of SFF. Another example of the New Age in the Presbyterian Church is Pastor H. Richard Neff, of the Christian Community Presbyterian Church of Bowie, Maryland. He authored the book Psychic Phenomena and Religion. He states in his book, occult practices may be beneficial and helpful for many people. p.166, Presbyterian Pastor Neff believes that only fraudulent mediums are bad, and he advocates mediumism for others. CF pages 166-7, 130-1, etc., Notes 1. Laterett, Kenneth Scott. A History of Christianity, Volume 2. New York, Harper & Row, 1975, p. 1231. 2 Ibid 3. Holmes, Arthur F. The Idea of a Christian College. Grand Rapids, M.L. William B. Eerdmans, 1975, page 19. 4. Numerous books refer to Anderson. Two references may suffice here: Ferguson, Charles W. 50 Million Brothers, and Jack Harris's Freemasonry, The Invisible Cult, page 113. 5. 1982 Yearbook of American and Canadian Churches as quoted in the World Almanac 1983, page 353. 6. Standard Freemasonry, page 40. 7. Proceedings. Grand Lodge of California, 1889, page 58. Proceedings. Grand Lodge of New York, 1890, page 37. The Primitive Methodists. Some men who have joined the Masonic Lodge are difficult to understand. Lorenzo Dow is one of these. Lorenzo Dow was solidly behind the Masonic belief system. He joined the Freemasons in 1824. Some of the things he wrote sound like Universalism 3, but he wasn't really theologically a Universalist. Most of the people he preached to didn't understand where he was coming from either. Lorenzo Dow was the catalyst that caused Hugh Bourne and a friend William Cloves to establish the Primitive Methodists in 1811. Several denominations experienced primitive movements, for instance the Primitive Baptists. The idea of primitivism goes back to Rousseau and Diderot's writings. Both were Masons. There are parallels in Freud's Civilization and its Discontent and Spengler's Man and Technics. Nature is the norm. The world goes in cycles. And we are returning, that is recycling back into another golden age. The Mason Thomas Paine encouraged this type of thinking. We have it in our power to begin the world over again. For indeed, Billington in his scholarly work Fire in the Minds of Men, shows how the word revolution was coined by the occultic secret societies because they believed that an upheaval would precede a revolving back to the conditions of an ancient golden age. Lorenzo Dow was sincere in bringing people to Christ, albeit his understanding of Christ, which many considered heresy. He traveled almost non-stop for his lifetime, and likely preached to more people in his life than anyone else in that time. 5. He was called crazy by many. Some called him a mystic. 6. He was very keen on prophecy, and preached it a lot. He preached often on paradise and hell. During his non-stop traveling, Lorenzo Dow was a constant visitor to Masonic lodges, to their chapters, and their commanderies 7. Yet his memoirs mention nothing about such an important part of his life. There is not the slightest hint of involvement with the Masons, and in his memoirs there is but an offhand remark on page 122 about a lodge meeting going on above him in a tavern he was staying at while he was trying to sleep. Why is he silent about his involvement? The primitive Methodist church that was set up had 12 permanent members who ruled. Later in 1846, 24 guardian representatives were selected and legally invested with the primitive Methodist church's property. It wasn't until the next century that democratic procedures began. What was the primitive Methodist church like when Russell's colporteurs found them? Apparently, the Masonic influence was strong. John Whitaker, a primitive Methodist minister, exposes the Masonic influence when he describes his denomination: "The desire for latitudinarianism has wrought untold mischief in our church. Theosophy, Swedenborgianism, Unitarianism, and even agnosticism are rampant today within our borders. It is time the church was purged." 8. In England, Charles T. Russell's preachers found the primitive Methodists and Free Methodists very friendly. Bro J. B. Adamson, in a letter reprinted in the Watchtower in 1881, states found the Free Methodists very fair. "The treatment better than I got anywhere else. Gave the pamphlet to 16 preachers and 100 of the most intelligent of the church membership." 9. It's possible some of the primitive Methodists heard of the Watchtower movement in the Masonic Hall or at some Masonic function. The 1991 yearbook, for the Jehovah's Witnesses, 10 records an early Bible student preaching to the Masons in their Masonic Hall. What did he preach on? He showed them the pyramid diagrams in the front of Russell's Volume 1. Interestingly, the Masons used Piazzi Smythe's diagrams also in their literature, such as Manly Page Hall's The Secret Teachings of All Ages. They must have felt comfortable with Russell's pyramidology. At any rate, there is the possibility some primitive Methodists might have learned about the Bible students through lodge functions. In England, many primitive Methodists joined Russell's movement. 6 primitive Methodist ministers joined his organization en masse. 11 In the Watchtower, February 1884, page 2, the problem is mentioned that Russell's followers were being mistaken for Universalists, primitive Methodists, or Adventists. New readers in all parts of the country are constantly inquiring, "By what names do you call yourselves? Are you primitive Baptists? Are you missionary Baptists? Are you Universalists? Are you Adventists? Are you primitive Methodists?" 12 As this book is documenting, the Universalists, the primitive Methodists, and the Second Adventists all have strong Masonic connections. As this book has made it clearer what the early Watchtower Society was like, in contrast to today, and how much closer it was to Masonic thinking in its early years, it is not such a surprise. Indeed, it is understandable how the Watchtower Society could be mistaken for being Universalists, or Primitive Methodists. The not-so-primitive Methodists, most of the Methodist groups have been progressive. But what are they headed toward? The book, Prominent Personalities in American Methodism, by Howell, gives an authoritative listing of the various lodge affiliations of prominent Methodist leaders. According to our compilation from this book, bearing imprint of 1945, 29 out of the 36 active bishops are members of secret orders of one sort or another. 21 of the 36 are members of the Masonic fraternity, many of them holding the higher degrees of the order. The best qualification for becoming a bishop today is that one be at least a 32nd degree Mason. 13 Perhaps better than showing lists of Methodist bishops who are Masons, is just to get to the bottom line: the United Methodist Church wants a one-world government under the New World Order. The United Methodist Church, Rocky Mountain Conference, wrote Press. Reagan in 1983, resolved that to ensure world peace and disarmament among nations, we United Methodists of the Rocky Mountain Conference urge the President and the Congress of the United States, in concert with all other willing nations, to call a World Constitutional Convention to reform the United Nations into a federal, representative world government. 14 Masons like 33 degree Mason James C. Baker, who is president of the Methodist Bishops, and Vern Dale Johnson, chairman of evangelism for the United Meth Church, have been directing affairs on the national level. Men like 33 degree Mason William E. Schooley, Board of Trustees Metro Memorial Methodist Church Shriner, and into the side orders of Masonry, are on the local level. There are so many Methodist Masons in England that they have their own lodges called Epworth Lodges, named after John Wesley's birthplace, Epworth Rectory. 15 The Moravians, a Gnostic sect who called themselves the Moravian Brothers of the Order of Religious Freemasons. 16 Played an important part in the founding of Methodism. Moravians played a decisive role in the origins of Methodism, which helps to explain the enthusiasm of both. True, John Wesley's group at Oxford, already called the Enthusiasts and the Holy Club, was active before the Moravian Peter Baller came upon the scene. Still, it was Baller, whom Wesley met in Georgia and then again in London, whose glowing pietism had such an effect upon the father of Methodism. It was Baller who in 1738 helped Wesley turn his attention inward to discover a new wellspring of religious feeling, and it was Baller who suggested establishing the Fetter Lane Society in London, which Wesley patterned after several Moravian meetings already in existence. 17. John Wesley advocated universal redemption, which emphasized salvation as an option of man's free will rather than God's free grace. Until American independence, the Methodist ministers under Wesley's authority in America and England were considered a society whose members were scattered within the various Episcopal churches. The American colonies' independence caused Wesley in 1784 to send Rev. Thomas Coke to organize the Methodists into their own congregations. 18 United Methodists and Youth in 1972, the United Methodist Church sponsored me to go with the Kansas East Youth Study Group. The tour was well planned and well executed. The group was part of the United Methodist Church's program to raise up church leaders. The group consisted of UM teenage leaders. I was an exception. I was Baptist. I still have the papers and items from the tour. The group met Methodist leaders including the head of the United Methodist Church, Pentagon people, congressmen, UN people, and revolutionaries from Angola. While our group was decidedly anti-Vietnam War, it seemed that our group did not connect the contradiction that the United Methodist Church helped finance the communist revolutionaries we talked with. I am grateful to the United Methodist Church for the opportunity to experience the group. In the context of this book, it could be mentioned that the Jewish and Masonic undercurrents within the UM Church were visible throughout that trip. Some of the concepts that were stressed were civil rights, globalism, and liberation theology. Those concepts all tie in with the Powers' agenda to bring in the New World Order. The liberation theology and revolution that the United Methodist Church finances will be discussed in the next chapter. The small conservative denominations. To the credit of the small, conservative, independent churches and denominations, many of these are not part of the one world religion, but the power has still made serious inroads into most of them. What will the New Order do with these denominations? They have three options: subvert the leadership, if there is no hierarchy to subvert, then subvert the people, and if neither of those can be accomplished, then they will have to make an exception for these groups or eliminate them. We will examine briefly three small denominations that this author is familiar with that illustrate these three approaches. It should be noted that in prayerfully studying many religious bodies, this author hasn't found any that don't bear out the scriptures, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. What is presented is neither to build up or tear down the reputation of any group. Reputations are often simply men's images of something rather than the thing itself, but to plot the course of the one world religion as the New Order wars to destroy the last pockets of resistance to the one world religion. The next few years will decide whether they overextend themselves like Napoleon in Russia, or if they take over Jerusalem, figuratively, like the Babylonians and Romans did. Control the hierarchy. The Seventh-day Adventists have over 500,000 members in the United States. Started by a woman of Jewish heritage, Ellen Gold White, they have made the Sabbath a prominent part of their religion. This author has admired their church members for the standards that they have maintained, especially their stand against Freemasonry. This denomination has a hierarchy with a president. Every 5 years the denomination has a convention to discuss a particular issue that is placed on the agenda. For instance, recently they discussed whether women could become ministers. The easiest way for the New World Order to deal with such denominations is to subvert the hierarchy. That the hierarchy can be moved in such directions can be seen by their decision years ago, even before Roe v. Wade, to allow abortions 19 which even their people help perform in their hospitals. Maybe this author is off base on this next observation, but to think of an Adventist doctor eating health food for lunch, and then performing an abortion seems like a New Age value system. That is just one indication of a shift toward New Age morality. We see people like Seventh-day Adventist writer Rene Norberg and CO authoring a book with psychic Jean Dixon. Subvert the membership. Not all small denominations have a hierarchy. The Church of Christ are groups of independent churches. Although independent for many years, a few editors of Church of Christ periodicals and a clique of a few ministers were looked to for guidance. The trend within the Churches of Christ seems to be one that churches are moving away from looking to a few men for their direction. 20 Because there is no powerful hierarchy to subvert, the Masons haven't shown a great deal of interest in recruiting its ministers. This denomination has historically put no barriers or deterrents up against Freemasonry. Masons have had free access to church positions if they have wanted them. There are Church of Christ ministers who are Masons, and this author personally knows various Church of Christ churches with lay members involved in Masonry. One Church of Christ in California meets in a Masonic hall. 33rd degree Freemason and Church of Christ minister Forrest D. Haggard, who recently wrote Short Talk Bulletin, which is an attack on every Christian who criticizes the lodge. Haggard says that critics of the Masonic lodge can be divided into three categories: 1. Someone had a personality problem, 2. Political or religious dictatorships which oppose free speech often attack the lodge because it insists on such freedoms, 3. For money. Haggard even claims the lodge is supportive of it, the church. These groups of churches are showing movement toward the one world religion. They are adopting the ideas that New Agers are planting within the churches, using New Age language and moving toward ecumenicalism. In visiting with Church of Christ ministers, this author has experienced a lack of knowledge on their part as to what are New Age ideas as compared to biblical Christianity. By the way, there have been attempts to bring these items that this author is bringing up in this book before the Christians practicing them. Those that have been contacted by myself or others have stubbornly refused to listen, and so it is hoped that by some chance some of the many people contacted will read this book and see the bigger issues at stake. When a Church of Christ asks the United Methodist Church to have communion with it, the issues at stake are much larger than simply do we like them or not. Churches like the Churches of Christ are easy targets for the many schemes the New Order has thought up to subvert the churches. They in general fell for the one where, in exchange for signing on a paper denying Christ as the head of the church, the churches received a tax-exempt status. The Top Secret Operations Research Technical Manual Trademark SW7905. That the Bilderbergers Policy Committee uses, which is discussed elsewhere, Chapter 3.6. Spells out one of their methods to subvert the Christians. Because the Church of Christ doesn't take a stand against military service, this tactic has been, and will be successful as one tool to subvert their members. Quoting one part of this trademark SW7905, we read, "Few efforts of human behavior modification are more remarkable or more effective than that of the socio-military institution known as the draft. A primary purpose of a draft or other such institution is to instill, by intimidation, in the young males of a society the uncritical conviction that the government is omnipotent. He is soon taught that a prayer is slow to reverse what a bullet can do in an instant. Thus, a man trained in a religious environment for 18 years of his life can, by this instrument of government, be broken down, be purged of all his fantasies and delusions in a matter of mere months. Once that conviction is instilled, all else becomes easy to instill. Even more interesting is the process by which a young man's parents, who purportedly love him, can be induced to send him off to war to his death." The manual goes on to say that part of the reason for drafting men is to corrupt them. Why? It further serves to make the youth as guilty as the elders, thus making criticism of the elders by the youth less likely, generational stabilizer. It is marketed and sold to the public under the label of patriotic equals national service. In other words, the New World Order realizes that if the young men of this country have moral superiority over their elders, they will stand up to them when asked to do something amoral or immoral. By making them do things that they can be made to feel guilty for under the guise of defending their homeland, like fighting in Vietnam, they have eliminated moral opposition by creating another generation of guilt-ridden young men. This highlights what you will learn in Chapter 3.10, Where the Rubber Meets the Road, where we discuss methods to cope in a Christ-like way with the New Order. If there is a lack of safeguards for the Church of Christ churches, that is not the situation with the next denomination we will discuss. Elimination or special exempt status. Some groups like the Old Order Amish cannot be subverted by the New World Order because they are not part of the system, don't believe in serving in the military, and don't give much if any chance to outsiders to subvert them. When Hitler took power, the three Amish settlements in Germany were eliminated. The members of these CHAs disappeared. Because the Amish are independent church districts, many of which do work with other districts, it was a small victory for the government during the Vietnam War when the Amish churches decided to work together and be represented by a steering committee. But although this sets a precedence that the government will try to further encourage, it is a minor gain at best. The Amish churches will never give their autonomy away to some committee. This means that even if the government got in people they liked on a steering committee, it would have only minimal influence. Can the membership be subverted? Although it rarely happens, it isn't impossible. One major subversion took place over 200 years ago, when the Amish allowed folk magic to mix with their culture. When the Rosicrucian settlements fell apart, they joined the Mennonites in Lancaster PA and brought in many of their occult ideas. Other influences too have introduced occult practices. Although the famous Pennsylvania hex signs are more representative of the higher Pennsylvania Dutch churches, they and the magic they represent also been practiced among the Amish. Magic, astrology, and New Age healing have made solid inroads into the Old Order Amish. The Amish book which lists all their ministers is mixed with pages of astrology, and has been for decades. After writing an expose of astrology showing its Babylonian origin and its unscripturalness, this author sent the book to the publishers of the Amish calendar, their book listing their ministers, challenging them to leave the astrology out of the calendar. The challenge was ignored. The Amish have worked hard to remain a rural people. The farmers of this country are one of the true producers in the U.S. Most of us merely manipulate, or move, or rearrange what the farmer produces. The farmer depends upon the weather, the soil, the sun, and water. Because he is more dependent upon these things, he is often more dependent upon God. America has belittled and ignored the farmer too long. One weakness of today's society and the New World Order is their total lack of appreciation for the farmer of America. Someday that disregard may come back to haunt them. The push today by the power is for agribusiness and large Russian-type farms. It seems all the lessons learned in the communist countries will have to be rediscovered the hard way. 1. Denslow, 10,000 Famous Freemasons, page 327-2. Ibid 3. Dow, Lorenzo. History of Cosmopolite or the Four Volumes of Lorenzo Dow's Journal. Pub. Joshua Martin, 1848, pages 140, 351 and others sound like Masonic Universalism, albeit other pages seem to contradict this. 4. Reed, Daniel G. Ed. Dictionary of Christians in America, page 945. Denslow, OPCIT 6. Dow, Lorenzo, OPCIT, page 102. 7. Denslow, OPCIT 8. Primitive Methodist Leader, March 3, 1921, page 329. 9. Watchtower R. October. November 1881, page 298-10. 1991 Yearbook, Watchtower BNTS 11. Convention Souvenir Notes, 1910, page 57-12. Watchtower 2/1884, page 2, Watchtower R 1879-1887, page 584, quoted also in Watchtower March 1, 1979, page 16. 13. Massalink, William. What is wrong with the lodge? Chicago, IL, National Christian Association, pages 23-24. 14. Quoted in Ferenc, Benjamin B. Planet Hood. The Key to Your Survival and Prosperity. 15. Dewar, James. The Unlocked Secret Freemasonry Examined. London, William Kimber and Co. Limited, 1966, page 51. 16. The Moravians also go by the names Order of the Mustard Seed, and the Church Unitas Fratrum, and Heron Hutter. 17. Lovejoy, David S. Religious Enthusiasm in the New World, Heresy to Revolution. Cambridge, M.S., Harvard University Press, 1985, page 164. 18. Gorey, Revelation Page Douglas. History of the Methodist Episcopal Church in the United States. New York, International Book Company, 188, page 63. 19. Information on the Seventh-day Adventist acceptance of abortion can be picked up by reading their various periodicals, for instance, Signs of the Times, had a Questions to Youth where they state they have no stand against abortion. The Adventist Review and Herald, which cover conferences, also has articles that touch on the subject. Religions of America by Leo Rosten, Simon, and Schuster, 1975, p. 252, quotes the late SDA, Seventh-day Adventist, Minister Arthur Maxwell's statements in favor of abortion. Arthur S. Maxwell was the editor of Signs of the Times, the leading evangelistic journal of the SDA. He also authored over 90 books. 20. Informed observation by a leading Houston, Texas Church of Christ minister in a talk October 20, 91. Billy Graham and the Bible scriptures tell us that the love of truth will protect God's people in the end times from deception. Let us not run from our sins but pray and hope our sins will be revealed, so that we can repent and draw close to God. The Bible is very frank to expose the weaknesses of great men of faith like Peter. What if you found out that the real character of Billy Graham, who is especially well spoken of by the secular media, was not his television image? What would you do? Someday the truth about Billy Graham will be known, and many people will fall away from Christendom. If you love the truth, you can help Christ's body begin a healing process to overcome some of that falling away. Faithful men of God have lovingly written Graham to help him, but he has established himself as his own authority surrounded by his friends. Today you have the privilege as you read this to quit trusting in a man, and to place your trust fully in Christ. Before Billy Graham falls, you can begin warning your friends to place their trust in God, rather than men, especially media-built images. Billy Graham is a 33-degree Freemason. Witnesses to the truth of Billy Graham's 33-degree Scottish Rite Masonic membership are many. Not only is this membership hopelessly at odds with Christ's teachings, but it reveals the satanic side of Billy Graham's character that the media hasn't told you about. Billy Graham groped blindfolded in the Masonic Lodge and declared before the worshipful Masonic Lodge master that he was in need of light. How ridiculous for a Christian evangelist who claims to have the light of the world, to beg a pagan hierarchy for light. Billy Graham has repeatedly taken blood oaths on penalty of gruesome death to keep the Masonic Lodge's secrets and to deceive others about their activities. When such a man as an international evangelist swears to be dishonest, is dishonest, and takes blood oaths, then this is a reproach on the Bible and on Christ. Are Freemasons like 33-degree Billy Graham trustworthy? No, according to the great evangelist Charles Finney, who left the Masonic Lodge when he dedicated his life to Christ. He said the Freemasons could not be trusted. Finney declared that Freemasons in the higher levels have lost their consciences because they have seared their consciences so much. According to Finney's warnings, Billy Graham would have a seared conscience. Finney spent his life warning Christians about Freemasonry, and if he were alive today, would likely be writing a tract like this. Does God's work depend on personalities? Which does God desire, for men to build names for themselves or for men to sacrifice all that they have so that God might be glorified. Can God miraculously lead men to Christ, or must millions of dollars be spent on Madison Avenue sales techniques and expensive crusades? Isn't there something wrong in the man-made character of the Billy Graham crusades? According to repeated studies, almost all decisions at crusades have been made by people who were already Christians. Was Christ wrong to focus on discipling, rather than spending millions for superficial mass evangelism decisions, most of which are not conversions, but mild renewals? Christ could have done it Billy Graham's way, he didn't. Christ made himself of no reputation. Phil 2, 7. Why is Billy Graham so popular with everyone, not to mention the important Christian clergy? If there are obvious flaws in Graham's character and the character of his crusades, why is he so popular? Consider the following and you will know better why Billy Graham is popular. First, his popularity began when William Randolph Hearst, the multimillionaire, began funding Youth for Christ and Billy Graham's evangelistic efforts. Billy Graham became a nationally known figure when millionaire Hearst publicized him through his newspapers in 1949. Hearst's influence got the national media to pick up on Graham. Billy Graham is indeed popular. So popular that Graham was described by Dr. G. Paul Musselman, "I call Billy Graham the greatest of the ecumenical voices." For Billy Graham is on record in support of the World Council of Churches expanding to include the other major religious groups in the world. 5. So popular that Graham was given his doctorate, yes, his doctorate is an honorary doctorate, by the Pope. The Pope must be pleased that Graham, on receiving his honorary doctorate, said that the Catholic Church is preaching the same gospel as he is. 6. It must be further reassuring that Catholics who go forward at Billy Graham crusades are referred to Catholic churches. 7. So popular that Cherot, NC has had a holiday named Billy Graham Day, and Billy Graham is heralded as a great Christian prophet. So popular that Christian publishers like to take things written by others and use Billy Graham's name because books with his name as author sell well. So popular that dyed-in-the-wool communists like him. They must have been pleased when Billy Graham was recorded on tape in an interview later published saying, "I think communism's appeal to youth is its structure and promise of a future utopia." Mao Zedong's 8 precepts are basically the same as 10 commandments. In fact, if we can't have the 10 commandments read in the schools, I'll settle for Mao's principles 8. So popular that all the presidents and many leading politicians worldwide have been close friends with Billy Graham. Billy Graham has given respectability to the presidents, including his good friend Richard Nixon. A well-researched article on Billy Graham in the Journal of Church and State concluded after examining Billy Graham's interaction with the various presidents since Eisenhower, could Graham speak the word of truth, especially when that word may be critical or slashing to the man in the White House when he is on such friendly terms with him? On the basis of the evidence now available, the answer must be number 9. So popular that men like the late Armand Hammer, who were prominent in the world's power structure and working toward an overt one-world government, have been able to get Billy Graham into any country. When Billy Graham went to India, he gave assurances that he was not going to proselytize any Hindus. 10. While in India, he spoke to Christians. If Billy Graham will not take on Hinduism, which is almost identical to the New Age movement, do you think he will seriously take on the New Age movement? Graham's tract A New Age is Coming can be used to legitimize the idea of the New Age. 11. When Billy Graham went to Israel, he gave assurances to the Israeli government, "I am going to address only Christian audiences. I have no intention of proselyting. In fact, I must be grateful to you for proselyting me." 12. When Billy Graham has gone to Catholic countries, his crusades have been helpful to the Catholic churches. After the National Council of Churches failed to pass a resolution declaring the NCC against converting the Jews to Christ, Billy Graham gave assurances to Jewish leaders that God had a special place for the Jews and that he rejected coercive evangelistic efforts by Christians to convert Jews to Christ. 13. All this cooperation with the Catholics and Jews is summed up by Billy Graham's statement in 1957, "Anyone who makes a decision at our meetings is referred to a local clergyman, Protestant, Catholic, or Jewish." 14. Jesus said, "Woe to you when all men speak well of you, for so did their fathers to the false prophets. LK 6:26 Christians, put on the mind of Christ, and as his disciples see things the way he sees things. Christ sat down, called the 12 and said to them, If anyone desires to be first, he shall be last of all and servant of all. MK 9:35 Whoever humbles himself like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. MT 18:4 The kings of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those who exercise authority over them call themselves benefactors. But you are not to be like that. Instead, the greatest among you should be like the youngest, and the one who rules like the one who serves. LK 22:25-26